But let's stand together, please, and open to the book of Jude. And I'm going to start where we left off last Sunday, which is verse 3, and just read through verse 7. So in verse 3, Jude says, "Beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. For certain men have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were marked out for this condemnation, ungodly men who turned the grace of our God into licentiousness or lasciviousness or lewdness, and deny the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. But I want to remind you, though you once knew this, that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed those who did not believe, and the angels who did not keep their proper domain, but left their own habitation, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness for the judgment of the great day. As Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them, in a similar manner to these, having given themselves over to sexual immorality and gone after strange flesh, are set forth as an example, suffering the vengeance or the punishment of eternal fire." Let's pray, please. Father, thank you that we can commune with you. You have created us to know you, to love you, to worship you, to enjoy you forever and ever and ever. And we ask this morning that you might help us, Lord, as we look at this very, very important part of your word, this aspect of your word. We thank you, Father, that we're not here alone, but the Holy Spirit is with us to teach us and to apply your scripture in our lives. And we open our hearts now. We ask you would help our hearts and minds to be very, very open to you. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Just a couple of, one thing I'd like to do before we get into the text very quickly, because this isn't really the message of the text, but it's a little bit of a character study linked to what we've looked at for the last couple of weeks. Jude as an example. And you know, you remember when you were learning to write, you would have a piece of clear paper, and underneath it were the words or the letters or the numbers, and you learned by the example that you saw, you learned how to write. And so the Lord has given us many examples, the greatest example being the man, Jesus Christ, and then those men and women in the Bible whom we can look to and we can learn from both their blessings and their mistakes. And Jude is a man who, first of all, was saved. And if you are not saved yet, the good news is that you can be. And after his salvation, Jude surrendered his life to God, and he became a servant of God. So he was saved, and then he began to serve. He also was a man who understood what the Christian life really was all about, the basic goal that the Lord has for his people and how he works in his people. You could say he was a man of the word, because he told his readers, he said, "You've been called by God." And they had answered the phone. They had responded to the call of God. And then he said, "You're being sanctified. You're being set apart to God for his purposes. And you're also being preserved in Christ. He then prayed. He was a man of prayer. So not only saved, serving, a man of the word, but he was a man of prayer, as he said in verse 2, mercy, peace, and love be multiplied to you. And these are wonderful characteristics that are found in the life of a person whom God uses. And why would I say these things to you? Because I would think that down deep in your own heart, you also would like to be used by God. And you may have many fears, you may have many other things that are obstacles in your life, but just a few other quick little attributes, if you will, of Jude, and then we'll get into the text. He was diligently committed to the word, as we're going to see in just a few moments. He was writing a letter to probably just a handful of little churches. He also was very open to the leading of the Holy Spirit, because he was planning to do one thing, but then he changed gears, and he felt it necessary or was constrained to change gears. So he was committed to the word. He was open to the Holy Spirit to lead him. And then he was, thirdly, aware of the dangers that were creeping into the church. His eyes were wide open, very much like the concern we have about terrorists entering into our country unbeknownst to us, and the need to identify those people before they hurt us. So he was aware of the dangers creeping into the church. And then he understood, in light of those dangers, he understood the need for Christians to contend for the faith or to take a stand for the faith. And then finally, he also knew the truth about how God dealt with in the past, the far past, the not so far past, and how he'll deal in the future with people who have two issues in their life. One is rebellion against God, and two is sexual immorality. And he wasn't afraid to speak about the reality of the judgment of God, or about rebellion against God, or sexual immorality. He was what I call a well-rounded Christian. And as you look at what he said, you can see what kind of a person he was becoming. And the last thing I want to say, not so much about Jude, but to all of you that are here this morning, and particularly to the men that are here, to remind you again about tonight, one of the false measurements in ministry, the false measurements of success, and I certainly have been guilty of this myself, is that we often feel a Christian is really doing well if they're real involved in ministry. Now, should you be real involved in ministry? Absolutely. But is that the real measuring stick for what God would really have for you? And I would suggest to you, no, it is not. The real measurement of success in your life is not so much as what you do, it's what you are as a person. For example, in Psalm 1, where he opens that psalm up and he says, blessed is the man, or oh, how happy is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, or the word of God, and in it he meditates day and night, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that beareth its fruit in his season, and his leaf also will not wither, and so on. So what God is saying is, look, I'm more concerned with what I want you to become. And let me say this, if you become what God wants you to become, you won't have any problem doing what God wants you to do. It's just a natural, you will just naturally do the things that God wants you to do. And I think so often, pastors and congregants get the horse before the cart, and we falsely assume, well, if I'm, you know, serving here and doing this and giving and being faithful and, you know, I'm doing good in my walk. Well, those are all good things. But who are you as a person? What are you becoming? And so I'm so excited, you know, to along with our leadership, to be focused on that, on trying to help the men, that's whom we're trying to help. The women, they never need help. They're just fine. But I'm very excited about it. But, excuse me, but looking here at now the message that is in Jude, he starts there in verse 3 by identifying his readers by calling them beloved. Now, this isn't just a nice little word that sounds nice. It actually is a description of who these people who were Christians, who they were, and it's a description of who you are. If you are a Christian, you are beloved. The Bible says you and I love him because he first loved us. God actually loves you. He so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Imagine that. That whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. So it's good to be reminded that God loves you. And he tells those people that. And then he explains what he was doing and what happened and why he is going to say what he's going to say. While I was very diligent to write to you, so as a leader, he was investing himself in teaching the Word of God, in this case, through the writing of letters, I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation. He was going to, we're not sure of exactly what aspect of our common salvation he was going to write about. Could have been any number of things, but that's what he was writing about, just an encouraging letter about the salvation that God has given us. And let me pause here for just a minute and say, it's important for believers who are part of a fellowship to understand the job description that God has given to the pastoral staff, to the pastor, the senior pastor in particular. And you can find it in the book of Acts in chapter 6 when there were two groups of widows there in the early church, the Hebrew widows and the Grecian widows. And the Grecian widows began to complain that they were not being fed properly. The church took care of the widows, who were widows indeed, according to 1 Timothy 5. They were complaining that the Hebrew women were being taken care of, but we weren't. And so they came to the elders. They came to the apostles. They said, hey, we got a problem here. These people aren't being taken care of. And so what the apostles did, they said, well, look, we can see the problem, but it's not reasonable that we should leave the Word of God and prayer and go wait on tables. Now, it's not that they were above doing that menial work, but God had called them to the Word of God and prayer. So he said, you find among yourselves some people who are filled with the Holy Spirit, of good reputation, and one other criteria that I can't think of at the moment. And he said, you assign them the responsibility of taking care of this, and we will devote ourselves to prayer and the Word of God. And in my life, and this happens as you get older, you begin to realize, oh man, I wish I had done that, you know, earlier in my life. You realize what little time you have left to do what you are now learning that you should do. And it's not always been that way with me, but there's been long periods where I've really misplaced my priorities. And somewhere along the line here in the last few years, especially maybe in the last year and a half or 2 years, the Lord has readjusted what it is that I'm supposed to be doing. And I count it such a privilege to be able to spend most of my day in the Word of God and trying to pray as much as I can. And the importance of that is not lost on the fact of a pastor cannot give what he hasn't received. And so Paul the Apostle said, that which I have received, I'm giving that unto you. And so I appreciate so much the support of my assistant pastor and the deacons in this church, the elders in this church, who are helping the body, caring for the needs of the body, and thank you very much. I just appreciate it. And so Jude, there in verse 3, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. So when he says, I found it necessary, he's saying, I was constrained. So he was busy writing about the common salvation and writing this letter, and we're not told how this happened. It could have been that word came to him. I would imagine that's probably what happened, or the Holy Spirit could have just impressed upon him and made him understand what the problem was. So he said, I was constrained now to exhort you, change the whole focus of his letter, to exhort you, the readers, to contend for the faith, to contend earnestly for the faith which was once delivered to the saints. The word contend there means to stand for the body of truth once for all given, not to be added to or to be subtracted from. So he's saying to the readers, and this applies to you and I, that you and I need to stand, we need to fight for the faith, which is the truth of God, that doesn't need any subtractions, it doesn't need any additions, it has been delivered to those who have been set apart to God. We're to take a stand for it. And, you know, some things to think about. Let me go on, and I have a couple of questions here. The word exhorting, I just want to mention that word. I used to think exhorting meant really just lay it on people, you know, whip them, lay it on them. But really the word exhorting means to come alongside of people like a good coach would do. You know, we've all seen examples of good coaches and bad coaches. Good coaches, they come along and what do? They encourage their players. And what are they encouraging them to do? They're encouraging them to do the things they should be doing. So the gift of exhortation, you know that when you've been ministered to through the gift of exhortation, you just want to do what you know you should do. And God gives that gift. And we're to exhort one another. We're to encourage one another. So the encouragement here is to do what we ought to do in light of the problem which exists today as it did then, and that is to take a stand for the truth. Now, if you said this 30 years ago, it wouldn't be a big deal. You know, you just say, gosh, that's not a big deal. But it is a really big deal today to take a stand for the truth. And many of you know the political environment that we're in. Many of you know that where you work, you have to be very careful about how you conduct yourself as it relates to your personal belief, and it's getting more so day by day. But now in verse 4, he explains why it is that his readers and why we today need to take a stand for the truth. He says, for certain men have crept in unnoticed, who long ago were marked out for this condemnation, meaning they'd been ungodly for a long time. It wasn't anything new. And here's what they do, who turn the grace of God into licentiousness or lewdness or lasciviousness or immorality and deny the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, when we talk about contending for the truth once for all delivered to the saints, we're talking about something that's very unchangeable. Some things in life are relative. For example, a person could prefer green over blue. No problem. It's not a big deal. A person might like popcorn and you might like potato chips. Preferences in some things don't really make any difference. However, truth is different. Truth is different. Why? It is absolute in the sense that truth remains fixed and sure despite human preferences. And so Jude reminds us that when someone says, well, I prefer to think of Jesus as just a good man, which many people do, we can't respond, okay, yeah, that's okay. But I prefer to think of him as God. Well, you think he's just a good man? Well, I just think he's God. That's not how we should do it. Contending for truth doesn't mean being hostile. You know, there's a group of Baptists, I don't want to mention their name, but they show up at the funerals of soldiers who've given their life to protect our freedoms, and they're just vulgar and ungodly, and they're hostile. And so when we start talking about contending for the truth, you know, some people say, well, I just tell the truth. Well, you know, and what they're doing is justifying their sharp tongue and their unkind manner. The Bible says, speak the truth in love. And so it's not a virtue. You haven't accomplished anything except destroying people when, well, I just told them the truth, you know. Well, yeah, tell them the truth, but do it in love. Put some sugar in the spoon and be loving with them. It doesn't mean shouting at people who don't believe, but it does mean making sure people realize that truth isn't a matter of preference. Someone may well say, I prefer to think of Jesus as just a good man, but when they do, that's our cue to answer, I'm really sorry about that. You see, the Bible says Jesus is God, the Son, and your whole future depends on whether or not you know and accept the truth of that claim. We need to be able to respond positively. And this is why it's so important for you as a Christian to grow, to put your roots down in the Word of God. In 2 Peter chapter 3, Peter exhorts his readers to be able to give a sensible answer to any man who asks the truth. What's this all about? One of the things that has helped me to realize how needy the average churchgoer is in a church and like this one, where the Bible is taught in an expository manner, verse by verse, on Sunday mornings and Wednesdays. Now, bear with me and don't be offended. Well, you might be, but don't take it offensively. But when I've had the wonderful opportunity to sit down with people in little groups of two or three or four or one-on-one trying to disciple them, I have realized, gosh, their understanding of these things isn't quite what I thought it was. And we talk about these things all the time at church. And it's helped me to understand and to drive me to try to clearly, passionately, consistently help you understand the Word. And for you to become a person who learns how to read your Bible on your own. Yes, you have to nurse the little child, feed them, you know, here comes the airplane, you know, and then after a while, you know, they're putting it, and then after a while, it's their greasy, I used to hate that greasy stage, you know. Go to a McDonald's, watch who was sitting here, you know, little kids. I'm OCD when it comes to grease. But can you imagine, oh, this is my son, he's 40 years old. Son, let me feed you now. He should have learned how to feed himself, right? You and I need to learn how to feed ourselves the Word of God. So I'm very, very excited. I'm very impassioned, and so is Pastor Mike and our leaders, And our desire as men to help the men in this body, it's not so much what you do, it's what you become. Because once you become what you're supposed to become, you'll do what you're supposed to do. And so, guys, you come tonight. I want to talk to you guys that especially have already decided you're not coming to this men's meeting if somebody drug you by the heels. Mitch. You just happen to be right there. I mean, that's the danger. That's the Bermuda Triangle right there. People who sit there, you're in a group. Okay, all right. Yeah. You just joined it today, I'll bet. No. But I'm being serious. It's not all academics. It's life transformation and changing through loving one another, developing relationships. And Pastor Mike tonight will wear jeans with holes in the knees. Shirt will be untucked and he's cool. No, I'm kidding. That's a bunch of baloney. So the truth. Now, what about these people that secretly come in? Well, there's a true story of a little girl who came home from her Sunday school class, as kids often do, with a little ribbon and then a little medallion that she had made. And on the medallion, it said, "I am forgiven." And wow, that's cool. Well, false prophets don't wear medallions around their necks announcing, "I am a false teacher." They don't do that. Instead, they slip in secretly. And they pretend to be believers, and only after being accepted by the body do they begin to smuggle their heresies into the congregation. If you'll look with me, please, to the Gospel of Matthew for a moment, chapter 7, I'd like to show you that this is a consistent matter from start to finish. We could go in the Old Testament, but the new will be plenty for us. Matthew chapter 7, verse 15, those words in red, if you have one of those Bibles. Of course, this is the Lord Jesus Christ teaching. And he says here, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. So they just look the part, but that's not what they really are. They want to eat you up and spit you out. You'll know them by their fruits, he says, and you can go on and read that. How about in the book of Acts chapter 20, the Apostle Paul, Acts chapter 20, he had ministered in Ephesus for 3.5 years, and he was leaving, he was passing by Ephesus again, and he had a little meeting with his elders. And in verse 27 of Acts 20, verse 27, you'll notice what he had to say on this subject. He says in verse 27, "While I was there with you in Ephesus, I have not shunned or avoided to declare to you the whole counsel of God." You know, there's a lot of parts of the Bible that are not real pleasant. It's easy to avoid them. Paul said, "I didn't avoid them. I taught you the whole counsel of God." Everything that God had given them at that time, he taught them. And for you who are newer to our church, the philosophy of ministry that we have adopted here and have for the last, we're in our, in July, we actually technically begin year 38, is to take you through the whole Bible, to teach you the whole counsel of God. From Genesis to Revelation, it takes about 5, 6, 7 years, but you get through it. And to go book by book, chapter by chapter, and verse by verse, that's as opposed to topical teaching, which is not sinful. There's a place for that. There's a time when you want to show somebody a topic in the Bible. It's not ungodly or anything like that, but the best way that we feel is to teach you the whole Bible, every verse in the Bible. So in verse 28, he says, you know, he's leaving. He says, "Therefore, take heed to yourselves and to all the flock. So you watch your own lives and you watch the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to shepherd or to care for, to guide the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. For I know this, that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. So there you go. There's a Jesus and Paul, and then in verse 30, he says, also, not only will they come in from the outside, but also from among yourselves. Men will rise up speaking perverse or misleading things to draw away the disciples after themselves. We've seen that in this church time and time and time again. And Pastor Mike and I can spot it a mile away. People, they just, you know, they have an agenda, it's a doctrine, and they just want you to take it, swallow it, and regurgitate it out to the flock, and if you don't, they're going to cause trouble. And so we don't have any problem letting them know that's not what we're about and it's not what we're up to. One other place I'd like to take you to here would be in the book of 2 Peter, 2 Peter chapter 2. Notice what he says in his little epistle, 2 Peter chapter 2. And remember, where we are here is Jude is explaining why we need to stand for the faith, because these men have come in, they've crept in. I rode from one airport, Hobby, to Dallas, or to the other airport there in Houston, once with an FBI officer, he and I in a taxi. They had to put us on a different flight, so we had a long time to talk, and this was a number of years ago, and we were talking about the danger of terrorism, and I said, well, what are you the most concerned about? And he said, the lone wolf guy. And I said, what's the lone wolf? And you know, he told me, like the guy in London the other day. Imagine the guy from Utah was there celebrating his 25th wedding anniversary. Can you imagine? Nice man and his beautiful wife, and she was injured and he was killed. And the reason lone wolves can do this is because they don't have any paper trail, no phone calls. They're just, you know, they're radicalized, they're motivated on their own, and you can't find them. But if you have a group of people trying to coordinate an event, then you can detect them a lot easier. So these people that come in to the church, you don't notice them. You got to be careful. Here in 2 Peter chapter 2, he says, but there were also false prophets among the people, referring to the Old Testament, even as there will be false teachers among you who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the Lord who bought them, and bring on themselves swift destruction. And then in 1 John chapter 2, just right next door, 1 John chapter 2, verse 18. First John chapter 2, verse 18, he says, little children, it is the last hour, these are the last days, and as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have come, by which we know that it is the last hour. And so then back in Jude here. So in Jude 4, he says, for certain men have crept in unnoticed. That church lacked discernment. The church of Ephesus in Revelation 2, 1 through 8, was a discerning church. Christ commended them for their ability to spot false teaching. But sometimes these guys can slip in. And the two things they do are they turn the grace of our God into lewdness, lasciviousness, sexual immorality, and then they deny or rebel against the Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. That's, you're going to see the pattern through Jude, those two things. Rebellion against God and sexual immorality. It's from one end of the Bible to the other, and it's in our society today. But these questions I wanted to ask you. This was written many years ago, Do you think we are in the same danger today? Do you really think that? Have you thought that? Is it something you're aware of? That in the body of Christ, that there are these heresies coming into the body of Christ? What would be some examples that you know of, if you know of any? You know, they're hidden. And why should we fight? Why should we fight? But you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. If you don't know the truth, you won't benefit from the truth. That's one reason why we should fight. How do you fight? That's another good question. How do you fight this matter? What happens if you do not fight heresy? And I don't like the statement that was made at one of our pastors' conferences a number of years ago. It's a nice sounding platitude. You know, well, we don't want to be known for what we're against. We just want to be known for what we're for. You know, that's, you know, yeah. You know, we don't want people to think we're mean and, you know. Well, then take out half the Bible. Let's start with the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt not. I mean, that's what God was against. Now, that isn't to suggest we should be fault finders and heresy hunters and that kind of thing. We should be known for our love for Jesus Christ. And the only way we can be known for our love for Jesus Christ is if we receive the whole counsel of God's Word and let the Holy Spirit teach us and lead us and love us. Right, Mitch? Okay. Mitch is my man. The double M. Mitch is the man. I'm telling you, that's the Bermuda Triangle. The people have sat there and we've never seen them. Yeah, that whole little corner. You're in danger, right? Yeah, I mean, I'm telling you, it's forewarning you. So now he gives some examples here. He says, I want to remind you. Now, let me just pause again. And he says, I want to remind you, though you once knew this. So there's something about the value of being reminded about things you once knew, because we can't keep everything we know right in the front of our mind. The Bible is so rich, it's good to be reminded of what's in the Bible. And it would be crazy, it'd be unhealthy for you to ever say, oh, I've heard that before. Well, listen, be reminded of it. Peter said, let me stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance. I'm in the book of Deuteronomy in the one-year Bible, which is for sale in our bookstore. I love that Bible in the book of Deuteronomy. And I'm thinking, oh, yeah, I remember these beautiful verses. I can't wait to get back in the book of Deuteronomy. Oh, man, these are so wonderful. I know that, but I'm getting them back into it again. I want to remind you, though you once knew this, and what he's going to do here is give three examples of how God has dealt in the past and then he's going to deal with examples next week in his contemporary time of how God has dealt with people who rebel against God and are sexually immoral. But I want to remind you that though you once knew this, that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed those who did not believe. I want to remind you of that. He saved them, and afterward he destroyed the ones that didn't believe. It's pretty heavy. Look with me to 1 Corinthians, please, chapter 10 for a moment, where Paul keys in on this very matter. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. He says in verse 1, and not believing is rebellion. It's rebellious to not believe God. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 1, he says, moreover, brethren, I do not want you to be unaware that all our fathers were under the cloud, all passed through the sea, the Red Sea, all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. They became connected to him as their leader, all ate the same spiritual food, the manna, the teaching, and all drank the same spiritual drink. They drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ, that water that came out. But with most of them, God was not well pleased, for their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. Now, these things became our examples to the intent that we should not lust after evil things as they also lusted. And do not become idolaters as were some of them. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. You know, the time Moses was up on the mountain for a long time and the people began to murmur and complain, where is he? Why doesn't he come back down? Let's go back to Egypt. Aaron, you're our leader. Make us a new god. He took their gold. They formed a golden cow and he said, here's your god. And they began to drink and to revel in sexual immorality. And man, it was not good. And then he says here, in verse 8, nor let us commit sexual immorality as some of them did, and in one day 23,000 fell. Nor let us tempt Christ as some of them also tempted and were destroyed by serpents, nor murmur, complaining as some of them also murmured and were destroyed by the destroyer. So he says, I want to remind you what happens to people who don't believe or are rebellious against God. They wind up getting judged by God. God will judge them. And then back in Jude, in verse 6, he gives us a second example. The second example in verse 6, and the angels who did not keep their proper or their own domain, but left their own habitation, he has reserved in everlasting chains under darkness for the judgment of that great day. I don't have the time to turn there with you, but in Genesis chapter 6, there's a story there where the sons of God cohabitated with women. And it's believed that when one-third of the... I'm going to look at this crowd because there's nobody over here. No, I keep thinking I'm looking over here, but everybody's over... You know what? This is going to be Calvary Chapel half church from now on. But when one-third of the angels rebelled, a group of those angels came down before the flood and they inhabited these men who committed lewd acts with these women. And as far as God was concerned, that was a line that should not be crossed. And what God did is he took those angels and he put them in prison. If you look with me in 2 Peter, which isn't too far to the left there, I want to show you something and make another little point here. 2 Peter in chapter 2, verse 4, because you might be wondering, well, how many devils were those and what about the rest of them? But in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4, it says, for if God did not spare the angels who sinned, he can't be talking about all of them because they all sinned, but cast them down to Tartarus or hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved for judgment. Now, if he had put all the angels in there, well, who are we fighting? Who are these principalities and powers? But God judged these angels for their not only their rebellion against God when they rebelled with Satan, but their further rebellion and their sexual immorality. So that's two examples. And then in verse 7, he gives us the third and final example here this morning. As Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them, we usually don't hear about those cities too much, but it was, you know, an area that included these two well-known cities and other smaller, maybe smaller cities, we don't know. But as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them, in similar manner to these, those cities were acting like Sodom and Gomorrah. And here's what they did. Having given themselves over to sexual immorality and gone after strange flesh, which would be homosexuality and lesbianism, are set forth as an example of suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. God brought judgment upon them. Back to a couple of questions. What about your children's future? What is going to happen if there is no contending for the faith? What is the world they're going to grow, that they're growing up in right now? It's sure different than one I grew up in. The point here, and you'll see it all through Jude, is, you know, sexual immorality has been around from the beginning. It'll be around at the very end. Rebellion against God has been around from the beginning, and it'll be around at the very end. And God judges sin. He will most certainly punish the false teachers who share the spiritual and moral depravity like we see here. You know, there are mainline denominations today, and of course, using the word homosexuality and lesbianism, if you're listening carefully, also talked about fornication between consenting adults. So just, it's a fact. Not picking on anybody. Truth is truth. I have a son that's a homosexual, and I would ask you to pray for him. In fact, he and I, just last week, we prayed on the phone together. And I'm hopeful for him. He wouldn't be offended if he heard me. Probably will hear this. But there are mainline denominations today who allow homosexuals to be ministers. Men, lesbians, to be ministers and perform homosexual weddings in their churches. It is wrong. It's wrong. And so one of the other things that's on the queue for us here is the concern we have for your children and the children who are going to be coming to this church. We already minister to 300 kids outside of our church on a weekly basis. Jesus said, if you harm one of these little ones, woe unto you. That really touched my heart when I read that. God cares for these little children, and he doesn't want them to be hurt. And the world we're living in, the light is slowly going out. And the sensual, sexual stuff is coming at us like a tsunami. This is 29 feet tall here at that peak. The one that came against Thailand and Asia some years ago, the wall of water was 60 feet tall, coming at 500 miles an hour because of that massive earthquake. That's why big vessels, shipping vessels were found a mile or two inland. It takes tremendous force to do that. The point is that Satan is like a tsunami of sexual immorality. It's all in the television and on your internet. And you know, the people that watch you on the internet, Google, they watch what you watch. And if you start tinkering around with sexual things, they're going to make sure more sexual things appear on your page. They're very sharp marketers. All of a sudden, you're going, wow, it didn't used to be like, there's all these, what's all this stuff here? Because they want to get money. They don't care about your soul. So we're very concerned about the children that are here your children. It's not my job or the church's job to raise them. That's your job, but it is our responsibility to help augment what you do with them. And we want to provide you with workable material so that you can be at home during the week and have family time in a meaningful way with your kids. I so admire the parents who are raising their children the right way, and there's many that are. And if perhaps you are neglecting your children, stop it. They need you. They need your help. In closing, in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, as we celebrate the Lord's Supper this morning, I told you when we started Jude, this was a no-nonsense book. It's 722 verses. How many tweets would you turn that into? Who could do the math? Could somebody do the math for me and shout it out? How many tweets would it take? 722 words, not characters.
I don't tweet, so...
That's, well, you're Tweety Bird.
Yeah, I do that.
It's not important. You're not going to get any money if you get the answer, but just be funny. But, you know, we're going to celebrate in just a moment what's called the Lord's Supper. It's taken from the Passover when the Lord delivered his people out of Egypt. Egypt is a type of you and I being delivered out of the world, brought into the kingdom of God. And here in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, in verse 9, Paul says this, because this was a very lax church morally. This was one of the churches that was letting stuff happen that shouldn't. He said, "Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God?" It was a question. "Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God." Pretty simple. Notice now the next verse. "And such were some of you." This is so beautiful. "Such were some of you. But you were washed, but you were sanctified, but you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God." So as this letter was being read to the Corinthian church, he's saying, some of you were this way, some of you were that way, some of you were that way, but now God has washed you clean of your sins. He has set you apart to himself. He has justified you. You're not only not guilty, you're considered righteous before him, all because of what God did. So when we take these elements today, we're celebrating what the Lord has done for us. And the Bible instructs us to do it in the right way. What's the wrong way? The wrong way is to take it knowing that there's something amiss within our lives. You know, and I want to just take a minute or two here. Again, in reading the other day in the one-year Bible, when the Lord, through Moses, was telling the people to go in and possess the land. And you know, some people think crossing the Jordan is speaking of heaven. Did I already say this to you? No? Okay, I did first service. You get a little confused. They were to go into the land and fight all of those different people that were like ISIS and drive them out and possess the land. He said, this is your geography from here to there. You get rid of all these people and you possess what I've given to you. And he said, if you don't drive them out and you leave some of them, here's what's going to happen. Two things. One, they'll become irritants and harass you. And three, I will do to you what I was going to do to them. So to be irritated is like having a little grain of sand in your shoe. After a while, you can't even walk. At just that little grain, you should have gotten it out of there, because that little grain, it's irritating you. It's a picture of us not possessing the life, the abundant life that Jesus said, I have come that you might have life and life more abundantly, the Spirit-filled life. That's what God wants us to possess, the life that he has for us. And sin If we don't drive out sin in our life, it becomes an irritant and a harassment to us, and God will certainly chastise us. This is why we're called to live a holy life. I'm no different than you are. When I sit down, there's so many times I look forward to sitting down and talking to the Lord, and I begin to thank Him, and I'm just doing so well. You know, I'm talking to Him, saying, Lord, I love You, and thank You for this, and talking about that, and this and that. And then all of a sudden, I think about, there's this one little thing that... it's not out of my life at the moment. It irritates the moment. It harasses me. And sometimes I'll say, well, Lord, you know about that problem. You know, you just kind of want to, can we talk about that later? In fact, once I said to him, could we discuss this later? I'd like to just, I just want to talk to you because I wasn't ready to deal with that sin. And you know what? God does not help people who help themselves. He helps people who ask for God to help them. That other one isn't in the Bible. You'd think it was. So when you take this today, if you've got a little grain of sand in your shoe, in your heart, that you know needs to be gone, just ask Him, Lord, please forgive me, help me, cleanse me. I want to give my life to You. So if the ushers will come up, please, they're going to distribute the elements. And if you'll please hold on to them till we all have them, and we'll enjoy this beautiful worship song in the meantime.
My Jesus, I love You.
Father, I'm reminded of when your son said to those men who were there trying to trick you and had brought the woman caught in the very act of adultery, and you asked them, "He that is without sin, let him cast the first stone." And so, Lord, at this moment, we're not wanting to think about someone else's sin. We'd like to ask you to forgive us of any sin and anything that is disturbing our fellowship with you. And then, Father, your son said to the woman, "Woman, where are your accusers?" And they had all left, and she said, "They're all gone." And he said, "Well, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." And so, Father, thank you for not condemning us. But, Lord, help us. We believe you, but help our unbelief. And, Lord, those irritants, those things that harass us, that we are uncomfortable with, we know or believe that they're not right. Oh, God, we ask for your help. And having said that, Father, we want to just thank you for being so faithful, and thank you for providing for our salvation and for our eternal blessedness with you. And so let's take the bread and take it together. It represents his body that was broken for us, and let's take the juice together. His blood that was shed for us. Lord Jesus, thank you. We pray, Lord, that you would fill us afresh now with your Holy Spirit. Baptize us with the Holy Spirit of God. And Lord, as we hear now just some important ministry things, we ask that you'd guide us as we listen. In Jesus' name, amen.